Good morning, the participants for today's talk. The title of today's talk is Solar Activity and Magnetic Cycles. So far, we had discussed about the global properties of the sun. How do we obtain from observation the global parameters about the sun and the internal structure, standard solar model. The probing of the interior by detecting the neutrinos and helioseismic methods. And then we also talked about observing the sun from ground and from space. From ground observations, we saw various types of features which we can resolve on the solar photosphere, troposphere, and corona. And most of these observations which we showed, they showed variety of features, physical processes which take place. And we mentioned that sun goes through various manifestations like quiet phase of the sun, and then active, dynamic, and explosive phases of the sun. So today's talk is basically on solar activity. We see that sun changes its structures, the basic features which we observe, their structures, their numbers, and their quantities from time to time, because we all know that sun is a hot gas, is not solid. It doesn't maintain solid features like what we have on the Earth, which also change over millions of years. But on the sun, there are changes which take place on various time scales, from 2 seconds to few minutes to hours to days and weeks and years. So there are various types of activities, and we had shown some dark features which are called sunspots, which actually occur on the photosphere on the sun in a very significant manner, a very observationally very easy to detect them. And we see corresponding signatures around the sunspots in various other layers, higher layers of the atmosphere of the sun, in the chromosphere and the corona. So we will discuss today about the signpost of solar activity, basically in the form of sunspots, where the variations over time and things are observed in this talk. So with this brief introduction about, let us come back to the sunspots, which are signposts of solar activity. The number and the sizes, they are basically the signposts signatures of solar activity. First of all, what is the life cycle of sunspot groups which appear on the sun? They seem to follow some kind of a pattern about their birth and decay with time. The first indication of the sunspot formation is basically in the form of bright faculae, some kind of bright features which we see in high resolution photospheric images, some kind of heating, slight heating at the photospheric surface before the sunspot as such shows up there. So this actually bright faculae is the indicator of the arrival of magnetic flux cube, because we talked about the sunspot as a three-dimensional entity which is in the form of magnetic flux tubes, which are pushing into the photosphere from the sub-photospheric layer. Basically, this happens because of the interaction between the convection currents, which are interacted upon by the differential rotation of the sun. As a result of that, these flux tubes are enhanced in strength, and they start rising up because of higher magnetic field. They have a buoyancy, and they start pushing into the higher layers of the sun. So as it pushes against the photospheric layer from below sub-photosphere, you see it as a brightening in the form of faculae. And as the days goes on, the spots form. You see small fragmentary spot features, which we initially call as a pore, and it you know, later on one sees a bipolar structure which corresponds to a following or F spot is a, you know, F and P is for preceding and following. This is a nomenclature. Other is called as a north and south polarity sunspot. So first you see a preceder spot and then it follows with you know, some more opposite polarity following spots, and as it grows further, the smaller spots seem to come together and they become bigger by merging. And the preceding spot develops a penumbra as it becomes, you know, the days go on, you'll find that distinct penumbra, umbra and penumbra. We discussed that the darker part of the sunspot, the inner central darker part, is called an umbra, and around that there's a penumbra. Basically, the umbra is the location from which fields are vertically coming up towards us, and penumbra is where it's making some kind of a canopy along which the magnetic fields are going back to the photosphere, making angle. They come up and then go down. So it is a penumbra. So that penumbra develops slowly as the sunspot becomes bigger and bigger. So overall, one sees a dipolar structure for some simple bipolar sunspot, but there can be mixture of those. During the next few weeks, the sunspot group grows further, and many other smaller spots form between the main preceder and follower sunspots. So between the two main sunspots, there can be many other fragmentary structures of many small spots, and it becomes more and more magnetically more and more complex, and then there could be some explosive events called solar flares and CMEs, which we have not yet discussed, but many of you must be knowing about them. So there are the possibility that as the sunspot grows further, there are many spots in between the main and preceder and follower spot. It could become a complex enough to give rise to explosive events. Large sunspot groups make, you know, they go around the sun as the sun rotates. The photosphere actually carries these sunspots as the sun rotates from, you know, over the hemisphere of the sun from the eastern limb to the western limb. And many groups can survive over several rotations. One rotation, as you know, that it takes roughly 28 days to go around the equator. So as it goes from eastern limb to western, goes behind our sight to the other side of the sun, and then comes back again after another 14 or 28 days. So similar, this is one complete rotation. This, people call Carrington rotation. So it can survive, the big ones can survive one rotation, full rotation. It can go over to second rotation and so on. And then gradually these sunspot magnetic fields, they diffuse. So they decay with time simply by diffusion or by submergence into the photosphere. The initial P spot, which was first seen, is usually the last one to decay. So this is how this is the life cycle of a sunspot group. So normally the formation of the, you know, takes for the sunspots anywhere between 15 to 30 days, and then slow decay can be for weeks, sometimes for months. Sometimes, of course, there are some quick sunspot groups come up within a day. You can see that a sunspot group has born. So these are some exceptions. So sunspots are basically classified depending on their complexity, their structural details, morphological details, in various groups by McIntosh sunspot group classification. So various types of sunspot groups are classified based on their structure, you know, which we see in the photosphere. So the McIntosh classification is based on the class, where you describe by a letter A, B, C, D, you know, that on, so on, depending on their sizes. And the second letter is whether it has got a penumbra or not. So penumbra is given by the second quantity, like x, y, and so on, and the sunspot distribution, how the sunspots are distributed, that is the third number. So these are all basically DEF. You know, these are basically called. So class, the class of sunspot group is single is A, and pair is, you know, like they occur in pair. So B or C is a bigger pair, is like that, B or C. Complex groups are D, E, F, where many, many sunspots are there. And similarly, penumbra, when the penumbra develops, these are numbers H, K, and so on. So these are the basic magnetic sunspot based on the sunspot observation. But as we know, that sunspots, here we are showing you two pictures taken from HMI of SDO. Of course, these things can be observed from the ground as well. So here you see the white light image or continuum image, which shows the photosphere of the sun, yellow disk, which we see by normal eyes. And this is a corresponding magnetic field image called magnetogram, taken from space. So HMI magnetogram, corresponding one. So you can see around this sunspot group, you have a complex distribution of fluxes. Magnetic fluxes are positive, bright is positive, dark is negative. So you can see a complex structure of magnetic field even in those areas where you don't see visually a sunspot, but there is a magnetic field which is enhancing there, and later on sunspots will come. So here also you can see minus, plus, minus, plus. Here you can see plus, minus, that kind of structure you see. So essentially sunspots are the seeds of high magnetic fields. So one can actually classify the sunspot also in terms of the magnetic classification. One is McIntosh classification, is simply from the morphological white light imaging, and active region classification, because we now define sunspot group, their three-dimensional kind of formation, because the sunspots are just a two-dimensional foot point at the photosphere of a three-dimensional object with a plus two object. So essentially, sunspot can be considered a three-dimensional object extending from below the photosphere to the photosphere and above the photosphere in the form of magnetic loops. So these are called active regions, and essentially they have corresponding to sunspot, they have structural, you know, flux distribution of the of the magnetic field distributed according to the McIntosh classification. So one can use these also for classifying the magnet sunspots in terms of magnetic classification or complexity. So there are alpha type, based on magnetic classification: alpha, beta, gamma, theta, gamma, delta. So these are different things, where alpha is a single dominant spot, often linked with a plage of opposite magnetic polarity. Like in this case, there is a single dominant sunspot. If you see the white light image corresponding to this, you see a dark sunspot, but there is a positive flux or north polarity sunspot which is dominant, and there is some small structure corresponding to the negative polarity, and all around that you see very, very weak magnetic fluxes related to the super granular structure. Beta class is a pair of dominant spots of opposite polarity. Like here you have one negative polarity sunspot, and there is another dominant positive polarity spot. So there is a basic bipolar structure. So this is beta class. And beta gamma is bipolar groups having more than one clear north-south polarity inversion line. In fact, polarity inversion line is basically a line, neutral line between the two polarity regions of opposite fluxes. Like you have, this is south polarity, north polarity, and somewhere it must be a neutral line passing by where the magnetic field is nearly zero. So that is a neutral line. So if you have more than one neutral lines, then it becomes, there is a structure which is called as beta gamma group, And finally, that delta or beta gamma delta also we cause when it is very complex with several inversion lines, and there are several opposite polarity fluxes within a single penumbra of you know, there are some spots, like here there was a spot within one umbra of this spot, you see two fluxes of positive and negative. So there are such spots, like here also there is a small delta spot of positive negative fluxes. So within one single penumbra, if you have more than one polarity umbra, then you call it the delta spot, which are basically very, very unstable situations where it can give rise to complex, I mean, the explosive events. So these are basically McIntosh class and sunspot and the magnetic classification. These are two classification systems for the sunspot. Before we go to the activity cycles, we are introducing these things so that one can understand what cycles are. And these active regions which we see on the sun, they are given numbers. You know, when you see solar images corresponding to a day taken from ground or from space, they are given some numbers for their identification. So the naming of the sunspot groups of all the active regions. So earlier, traditionally, sunspot groups were named according to you know, their appearance on the photosphere of the sunspot. And they were given by individual observatories around the world. I mean, there were numbers given by Mount Wilson, Hale numbers, and so on. And you know, similarly, in some European observatories in India, from Kodaikanal observatory, we have more than 100 years of observation of the sunspots. So they also used to get their own numbers because those days the communications were not that good. But nowadays, sunspots are basically considered in terms of active regions as a three-dimensional entity, not just sunspot, which is a two-dimensional entity at the photosphere normally. So the active regions are nowadays named by NOAA of USA, National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration, which has started giving these numbers from January 5, 1970 onwards. The spot which was first seen on January 5, 1972 was given the active region number 0001, so active region number 1. And from there, active regions are being numbered consecutively as they appear on the visible side of the sun. As the east side and the west side, as the sun is rotating from east to west, the new sunspots will come from behind, and their numbers will be given from the consecutive, you know, increasing order. So that is how, as the sun rotates, long-lasting active regions may also reappear. Sometimes it may happen that such a long, big one, for example, it can go behind the sun, come back in little bit different structural form, but it reappears. But they are again given a new number. You know, not the same. Thing. For example, this is a picture taken on October 28, 2003, where quite a few active regions are seen. You can see 10488, 10487, 10486, and so on, depending on their appearance on the sun. You can see this 484. After that, 485 is not there. Probably it was seen first, it has probably gone behind, and then 486 and so on. 488, 488 was actually after this, although it is in the little bit towards the western side, but this very rapidly was born and grew. So this was seen only after 486, so it has become 488 and then 487 and so on. After this, 492, so that means this must have come afterwards, after this thing was seen. So this number can look haphazard, but they have numbers assigned to them as per their appearance on the sun. So around June 14, 2002, this 10,000 number was named, and normally for brief briefness, people use only four digits, like for after 999, this becomes 10,000. So this becomes 0000 instead of 10,000. And 10484 is normally referred as 0484. If you give the date, you'll know it should be 10,484. So this is something about the nomenclature. And normally, when these active regions are on the sun, they show some, basically they appear as a bipole, as we discussed, in the alpha type or beta type. So one can define a magnetic axis joining the sunspot of opposite polarity, where this P spot, that means this must be having a one type of polarity, in this case positive polarity, and following spot has negative polarity. So one can join the centroids of these two, that is defined as the magnetic axis of this spot group. And it has been seen that these magnetic axis make some angle with the direction of east-west rotation of the sun, which is the equatorial direction. So normally there is a tilt of the magnetic axis of active regions which has been seen, and that seems to follow some kind of rule that basically the magnetic axis are tilted to the equator by roughly 5.6 degree. It can be little less or little more depending on the latitude, and this tilt, which is average is 5.6, it increases with latitude. The higher latitude, that is towards the polar side, of course they don't occur very high in the latitude. They are normally plus minus 40 degrees, also that is the active latitude belt within that. So within this belt, the tilt increases with latitude. By this relation, you can see where this is the latitude and this is the tilt. So this is called the Joy's law, which is related to the solar activity cycle, which we'll see. Okay. So here we now define the sunspot number, which is the indicator of solar activity, after discussing the some of the properties, some of the classification, some of the things like the Joy's law. Let us discuss the sunspot number, which is indicator of solar activity. Sunspot itself is the indicator of solar activity. Whenever a sunspot comes, it shows up some activities around that. So sunspot numbers, how many of them are there, that will give the degree or overall level of activity on the sun. So sunspots are indicators of enhanced activity on the sun. They have been reported even before the telescopes were invented in 1605 by Galileo and his contemporaries in Europe. But even before that, some very large sunspots were seen by Chinese and Egyptian astronomers by naked eye. When sun is very close to the horizon, the intensity becomes low because of it has to pass through thicker layer of the dust and atmosphere of the earth. So at that time it is safe sometimes to see the sun for a longer time, and some very large sunspot groups show up even by naked eye, like in October 2003, this activity, the active region, was seen by naked eye. So even in the past it was seen, but so that way they were observed. But regular intensive observations started after the telescopes were built, and from somewhere around this time onward there is a regular observation. And it has been noticed that the sunspot appear and disappear, and there is a pattern of this. So this was realized there at that time after the sunspots were observed by the telescope. So the number of sunspots are normally counted over the entire visible side of the sun, which is towards us, and we count them, and then they are plotted on a daily basis or monthly basis. The sunspot number you can average out on monthly basis, weekly basis, or yearly basis, and then you find that there are some interesting trends which emerge about the temporal behavior of the sun. And this kind of pattern, which basically looked like some kind of cycle of activity, was discovered in 1843 by Schwabe, who noticed a variation in average sunspot number by using the sunspot observations over around 17 years. Later on, Wolf compiled the sunspot numbers and constructed the cycle back to 1745, eventually pushing these reconstructions to the observations by Galileo and contemporaries, the early 17th century. So people could construct from scanty, sporadic observations all the way back toward the 17th century, but somewhere around this, it was noticed that sunspots seem to follow some pattern, cyclic pattern. So what is sunspot number? Essentially, as we said that, these numbers are just physical counting as a sunspot. So monthly sunspot number is given by the Wolf number, which actually, Wolf, when he was studying them from his name, Wolf numbers are given. They are also known as international sunspot number, relative sunspot number, or Zurich number, depending on, various bodies who make these things. These numbers are announced about these numbers on a given day. And this defined simply by a relationship, very simple relationship, where Wolf number is, some kind of a calibration constant multiplied by 10 times number of groups which you observe on the sun on a given day. Because we saw that sunspots appear mostly in groups. Sometimes you also see individual sunspots. So you can see how many groups are there. Like here you can see one group, another group of sunspots. So there are two groups. So essentially here you can say 10 into 2, so 20 plus F. And F is the number of individual sunspots. So you can count how many sunspots, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So here there are 5 individual sunspots. So F is 5 and G multiplied by 10 is 20. So you have 25. So that is a sunspot number. K is basically a correction factor or a calibration constant to take care of the telescope size, because different sizes will have different resolutions. So you can resolve even finer sunspots using bigger telescope with better resolutions, and also it depends on the turbulence and other conditions, atmospheric conditions, and depends on the ingenuity of observer in identify the find the sunspot. So normally people actually compare observations from various observatories and try to make a calibration constant for one to another observatory. So K is a calibration constant for a given observatory. So if you take assume K as 1, in this case, in this example case, it is R is 25. Okay, this is just for illustrating. Of course, you have much more complex situations. So if these sunspot numbers are plotted, along, in y-axis sunspot number or Wolf number, and in x-axis you are having years, so in which you can have a daily or a monthly average numbers is plotted, and these are given from somewhere from 1610 onwards up to present times. So one sees that the sunspot number show a quasi-periodic behavior. They go up and down, and their amplitude seem to change from one maximum to another maximum. So essentially, they are not very well-defined periodicities. I mean, their average length between cycle maximum minimum to minimum is roughly 9 to 14 years. I mean, they are not constant. 11 we call of 11 year sunspot activity cycle, but they vary from individual cases from 9 to 14 years, and average between maxima like here to this is 11.1 years. So this is a quasi periodicity, not exact. The sun is not exact, it doesn't behave like a 11-year clock in that sense. And also there is a change in the rise time and fall time. The activity rises and then falling, again rising and falling, and so on. So So activity, this, basically 11-year cycle, that means from minimum to minimum, 1 year. So within that, one can define a rise time and a fall time. So the rising, that means basically the spottedness of the sun rises to a maximum on the average in around 4 years and drops into minimum in 7 years. So there is a faster rise time and slower decay time of sunspot. So this is roughly 11 years in that sense. And you can also notice there is a very long period in record from 1645 to 1715. It was around 70 year span over hardly any sunspots were seen. This is called a Maunder minimum. This was the longest minimum on record. Normally, you see minimum period here corresponding to each solar cycle, which is there for some few years. But this was a period, a very long period of no sunspot activity. Coincidentally, it happened just after this period when the telescope had just started that Maunder minimum observed, and no such long prolonged period of low activity on the sun has been seen ever since from that period. But it may happen because sun at long time it may show such kind of thing. So it seems that there is a period of 70 years in which solar cycle appear to have completely broken down. And this long period of low sunspottedness on the sun coincided with a period of little ice age. Basically, the polar caps in the northern and southern hemisphere increased towards, in the case the Arctic Circle came almost up to the north, the European northern Europe. So it became very long period of cold phase on the Earth. So essentially, looks like somewhere connected with the overall climate. The spottedness of the sun is somehow connected with the spottedness of the sun, which is not still, I mean, is all still debatable, but it seems that there is a coincidence. So low solar activity appears to have played a role in the 17th century abnormal cooling. That's what is observed thing. And people wonder whether such a Maunder-like phase may again take place on Earth. And if it happens, what will happen to the climate? So as you saw, this activity, 11-year activity, it gives some kind of indication of modulation over longer periods of maxima, minima, if you put envelopes around this. So that means if you analyze the sunspot data, one can get information over the longer cycles apart from 11 years. And there are indications that there are longer periods like 80 year Gleisberg cycle and even 144, 145 years, 290 years. Such cycles are also present over and above the 11 year cycle, longer cycle over which sun goes through the things like some broad maxima like grand maxima, Maunder minima, Sporer minima, and so on. So there are many phases which one probably has. And if you take observations from over longer time, like late pre-Cambrian, Cambrian annual deposits or warps, which are laid down in deep lakes, basically the sedimentation takes place in the lake, very old lakes. One can see the deposits and their thickness and packing of the deposits. From there, one can reconstruct the long periods of the sun, and people have gone up to very long time and found out like 680 million years ago, and they still show that 11-year cycle was operating even long past millions of years before. Similarly, the tree ring observation, their dating and all that have given indications of, like carbon dating have given indications of Very old times when the Sunspot data is not there. So in this cycle you see 1100 AD, 1200 AD, 1300 AD, 1400 AD, from in which the solar cycles which are known from the Sunspot is confined here 1700 to around 19 in this map, but of course up to 2019 now we have. So the variations on the Sun, the Sunspot numbers are plotted here, carbon dating in terms of percentage. They are plotted here, the information from there are plotted here. So one can see long term cycles also. Coming back to the Sunspot cycles, these cycles are now numbered, as we discussed that from the invention of the telescope, initially rudimentary Sunspot numbers were there, but later on from around this time, from 1740 or so, the Sunspot numbers have been faithfully recorded by many observatories and they have been available. So people have started numbering them from somewhere in 1740 or so. So this is cycle number one. Cycle number one is to start with from 1740 onwards, and so that is how the numbering are given. Sunspot observations 1740 onwards, and present cycle which peaked around 2013-2014, which is now almost reaching the minimum like this. This year 2019, the cycle number 24, this is actually 23, so 24 is after this, the present cycle went down and came up. So somewhere here 2013-14 it peaked, and now it is declining, and it is going to reach the minimum this year sometime in 2019, and after that cycle number 25 will start. So this is how the various cycles are given numbering, one can understand when we say cycle number such and such. We can say so in the recent past, for example, cycle number 19, around 1960 or 1959-60 was the highest you can see here, and you can go back and see somewhere in 1900 or so, 1900 to 1910, it had the minimum kind of thing. So very small Sunspot number of around 50 here, and for this it is around 250 or so, which was basically International Geophysical Year, around which time the satellite observations were started. So that time coordinated study of the Sun was started in this period, and afterwards around each of the solar maximum people have coordinated observations. So other aspect of the 11-year cycle Sunspot number which you saw, that because we are counting the numbers over both the hemisphere, and we are essentially losing the location information where the sunspots were forming. We simply have integrated sunspot numbers in that. So that shows the activity sunspottedness in a way. But more information comes when we start putting the location information also. So if we plot the location of the sunspots on the visible solar hemisphere with time, we find there is a very interesting butterfly-like diagram emerges, which shows basically as the cycle progresses from, this is a minimum of this cycle, and then the back, other cycle starts. The starting the next cycle, you see the sunspots at higher latitude. And from there, as the cycle progresses toward the minimum, the locations of the sunspot formation region, these are not the same sunspot, but with time the new sunspots come, and you plot their position on the northern and southern hemisphere, you basically average out all the sunspots along the all the longitude, so only the latitude information. That you plot, then you find that there is an interesting migration of active zones towards the equator as the cycle advances. So this is called the Sporer's law, where we see that activity migrates toward the equator as the cycle progresses. So that is very interesting thing, you know, that variation of average spot latitude with the progress of cycle. Normally the first spots, as we say, they occur at the of a given cycle, occur at a high latitude, as high as 45 degree in the northern hemisphere, or minus 45, that means around southern. So for the larger activity like this one, which is 1959 or 60 IGY year, you see that sunspots can go to very high latitude, like 45, in case of 50 also. But for smaller ones, they are confined in plus minus 30 or 35. So depending on the strength of a cycle, they can occur at higher and higher latitudes. So, and also there are times when the, like somewhere here, you can see the spots of the previous cycle are observed at the low latitude, while around that time there are also some new spots coming at the higher latitude. They belong to the next cycle. So it can happen that there are times when you have sunspots from two cycles present on the sun, from the previous cycle as well as new cycle. And as we know, the sunspots are islands or seats of high magnetic fluxes. So if you plot the fluxes, magnetic fluxes corresponding to the sunspot, we get a magnetic butterfly diagram also. And in this, since we can see even those areas where sunspots are not seen, we can see the signal in terms of the polarization, which we can convert into magnetic flux using Zeeman splitting, as we discussed earlier. So even weak flux areas we can get. And if we plot that, this is a butterfly corresponding to the strong magnetic field area, which is the sunspots. And above that, these are the weak field areas where no sunspots are seen, but fluxes are seen. So one can see now that in magnetic butterfly diagram, there is a, equatorward migration of the magnetic weak, strong magnetic field, or the sunspots as they go from higher to lower latitudes. They are born in, from higher to lower latitude. In the same manner, the weak flux areas, they are moving towards the poles, the northern pole and southern pole. So there is a poleward flux motion and also equatorward motion, which is Sporer's law. So the solar magnetograms have been on a regular basis, have been available only from 1975 onwards, and it shows very interesting pattern. When we plot the strength of the fluxes, it shows both equatorward and poleward motion of fluxes. And actually, if you see it very carefully, it is found that the polarity of the polar magnetic field reverses at the time of the solar maximum. So around the time of the solar maximum, which is somewhere here, this is the beginning of the cycle, this is somewhere the maximum, you see that there is, the fluxes, blue fluxes, negative fluxes, they migrate toward the pole. And in the pole, which is basically was having, the adjusting, let us say at this point, this is blue, and this here it is the opposite flux moving and canceling out. Somewhere it will cancel out. So basically, from negative, the polar magnetic field will reverse, it will become positive. In the next cycle, again from the maximum, this will become negative, and so on. So basically, one complete cycle from negative, to coming back to negative comes to around 22 years. So there is a cycle of 11 years and a magnetic cycle of 22 years, which we can find from a magnetic butterfly diagram. So these are some of the very interesting things. There are similar to the magnetic flux and sunspot number, there are other indicators of solar activity which again show the same kind of cycle which we see from the sunspots. And these are basically related to the sunspot activity in the form of a radio flux of 10.7 centimeters, which comes from very close to the chromosphere, very close to the locations of the sunspot, just above the sunspot. As you go to higher frequency, that means lower wavelengths, these are basically coming in lower and lower layer of the atmosphere. If you increase to meter and kilometer, they are coming from outer corona and also almost close to the Earth, you know. So basically centimeters, 10.7 centimeter radio flux mimics the sunspot numbers. So if you plot 10.7 radio flux, which is this violet curve, which is here, this violet curve, this also seems to follow the blue curve, which is the sunspot observation, double hump, and this also shows the red one is solar irradiance, the solar power which is coming, and we are actually observing from space. So that one is the power which is observed at 1 AU. So that also shows the same periodicity as 11-year sunspot. Sunspot, as I said, is the blue. So blue and all of them are more or less matching. So the red one is annual mean, and there are daily fluctuations on daily irradiance. Solar flare index, we have not talked about flare, but the explosive events on the sun, they also follow the sunspot cycle, like this green curve. So any indicator we take, CME also we'll see later on, that CME also follows similar trend, that their number basically rises and falls as per the sunspot cycle or solar cycle. Here it just shows the same solar constant or solar irradiance plot with monthly sunspot number. You can see that these are taken from satellites, various satellites, and combined together, ACRIM and TIM and RB and so on. So they are all plotted here, although they show a lot of scatter, but the trend is the same as the sunspot. So the total irradiance has been observed from 1978 to 2010 in this diagram. They continue. So it's roughly three decade record of total solar irradiance. It shows the variation corresponds well with the cycle of sunspots with a very small relative amplitude, although their amplitudes are, you know, like 1360 watts per meter square. Here it is 1364 watts per meter square. So this is the solar power. So you can see the variations are roughly 0.04%. There is a small variation with the solar cycle. And this image shows, this plot shows the three recent solar cycles where sunspot numbers, smooth sunspot numbers have been plotted for cycle number 22, 23, and 24. So this cycle number 22, which is which had maximum 1990, and this is cycle number 23, which is roughly 2002-2003, is a double. Meyer effect is basically that anti-correlation. The rise time is longer, and you can see the correspondingly the amplitude is smaller. So this is called the anti-correlation of this rise time and cycle strength. So some of these things are used for making prediction of a given solar cycle. And the magnetic other thing which people see is magnetic polarity of sunspot group according to Hale's law, in which what is the way of magnetic polarity behavior of the sunspot group which are seen in the northern and southern hemisphere, they seem to be described by a common feature that in a given hemisphere, in a given cycle, the sunspot groups which come as a bipolar group, as we discussed, they seem to have same kind of polarity distribution. That leading sunspot is, let us say, positive or north polarity, and follower is south or negative polarity. Other spots also follow as they come up. They follow the same pattern of north and south. While in the other hemisphere, like in southern hemisphere, you see that it is reversing. The preceder or the main, the leader sunspot is south polarity, reverse of this. Here it is north polarity for the leader sunspot, which is in the westward in the direction of the rotation of the sun. Here in the opposite polarity, it becomes opposite. This becomes south north, south north. So they seem to follow this pattern, which is called the Hell's polarity law. So this is the sense of polarity opposite in two hemisphere, and it reverses at the end of each 11 year cycle. The next cycle, this will become south north, south north, and here it will become north south, north south. So that complete cycle for reversal back to the original north south in the this hemisphere will be 22 years. So there's again, as per the Hell's law, it follows a 22 years cycle for magnetic field. So magnetic cycle is 22 years. So these are some of the, you know, as summary what so far we have discussed, the main characteristic of a solar cycle. The first thing is we have seen from the sunspot number, the sunspot cycle follow 11 year quasi periodicity. And we, from butterfly diagram, we saw a Sporer's law. There is an equator-ward drift of active longitude, this should be active latitude as cycle progresses. There's a typo here. The active latitude plus minus 45 degree, as we discussed, it goes lower and lower latitude. And there is a, if you take the magnetograms, the magnetic butterfly, we see a poleward drift of magnetic fluxes. So a complete 22 year cycle from the Hale's law and also from the poleward drift of magnetic fluxes, we see that polarity reversal takes place at the time of the the maximum of a cycle, and it comes back again to the same position of 22 years. And Joy's law is basically, we see that the sunspot groups which emerge from the sun, they seem to have a small angle equatorward drift, a tilt of 5.6 degree, and reversal, which I mentioned, that it takes place at time of cycle maximum. So these are some of the things which basically can be modeled. People have tried to make models from all these things must have their relationship with something, some internal inherent property of the sun, which are basically the convection which creates the magnetic field of the sun, and the rotation, differential rotation. So essentially, there is a simple Babcock model which tries to understand the solar cycle in terms of alpha omega effect or the solar dynamo which operates inside the sun. So this one completes a Babcock cycle. Babcock Witten cycle is 22 years dynamo cycle, which corresponds to oscillatory exchange between toroidal and poloidal field. Toroidal field, as let us say, we consider this kind of wrappings of magnetic field along the north-south axis. So this is along the torus. So because if you consider a poloidal field is basically a simple field which is connecting the north pole to the south pole. And because of the rotation, differential rotation, which is fastest to the equator, it will take the magnetic field along the faster axis, and it will intertwine these. So basically, if you started with the poloidal field, it gets stretched because of the differential rotation of the sun. So that is actually converting from poloidal to toroidal. So this is actually kind of a dynamo cycle which operates. So there are various steps for these. We can consider that magnetic field deep inside the sun, interior. Yesterday we talked about the tachocline, where there is a shear layer. So somewhere there in the tachocline, the magnetic field is basically generated. Convection current is doing that, and shear layer is increasing that. So the submerged field lines are drawn out by differential rotation as they operate on the field and make them concentrated by twisting, increasingly twisting. So the magnetic field strength increases, and as a result, the magnetic pressure V square over 8 pi increases. So that means it becomes lighter, and as a buoyancy, because of the effect of buoyancy in stage 3A, for example, here, they will start rising up because the strength is increasing. Essentially, their B square by 8 pi increases. So speed decreases there, that means density decreases, so it will come up. And essentially, the twisting of the magnetic field in the deep interior is happening because of rotation, as we have mentioned, and that is essentially a Coriolis effect or alpha effect, which operates on the poloidal fields. So it twisted, it gets twisted, and the twist of the sunspot group essentially obeys, the fields are wrapped like this, and there is a small inclination of these flux lines. As the sunspot flux tubes come up, they will have a small angle because of this structure, which we see because of the high twisting. So as the cycle near the end, leading fluxes drift towards the equator, where their opposite polarities mix and cancel, and trailing fluxes drift towards the poles, where again the pre-existing polar magnetic fluxes are cancelled and replaced by the existing field. So this alpha effect later on regenerates poloidal field from toroidal field, and then entire sequence repeats, except that all polarities have now reversed from the previous cycle. So thus a complete magnetic cycle takes place 22 years. So this is a very simple model. People have different models for sunspot cycles. More complications are introduced. So basically, this is what I discussed here. The poloidal field is twisted, more and more twisted here. So you see, the spots appearing in these places, and the fluxes are drifting like here, plus minus. This minus polar field was plus, and minus flux is going towards that, cancels, and later on minus will dominate. So there will be a reversal of a magnetic polarity. So this is how broadly, in a qualitative manner, one can explain the solar cycle. So some recent inferences one has about what is more important for solar cycle: convection or tachocline, which is a shear layer. So some recent researches are there that although the tachocline has long been thought to be the key for generating sun's long larger scale magnetic field, but there are some questions from some recent research on brown dwarf. So radio observations of brown dwarfs, which are actually some 60 or 70 Jupiter mass, they are low mass stars, basically small dwarf, where fusion is operating what is very small scale. So the radio observation of the brown dwarfs have indicated that they also maintain large scale magnetic fields, and also they display cycles of magnetic activity like our sun. In the case of the sun, we have radiative core, which is surrounded by a convective envelope. In between, there is a tachocline. But in the brown dwarf, basically, they have all the way from the core onward to the surface, no radiative zone. They have only convective envelope. So that means there is no interfacing, because there is no radiative zone. That means there is no interface layer between the two types of zones, like we have in our case of sun. So they, brown dwarfs, lack radiative core. They have only convective core. That means there is no tachocline, yet they display solar-like magnetic activity. It has been seen, even for some other star, sun-like star, people have seen solar cycle-like behavior from, recent observation from astrophysiology and some other observations which obtain magnetic field of those stars, and the way they are changed, they also seem to show. But brown dwarfs seem to be a kind of counter example, and they still show some magnetic activity. So it has been suggested that the solar magnetic activity is generated only in the convective envelope of the sun, and tachocline may not be so much necessary for activity cycle as the convective fire, convective zone. So convective zone seems to be, there are indications that probably that is related to the, although we can still talk about shear layer for enhancing the magnetic structures and giving rise to the sunspots and all that, but cycle as such doesn't seem to be. At the end, I think we gave a graph here, which people have a lot of concern about global warming because of various regions and whether sun is to be blamed for this global warming. There were some questions about that. It seems that sun is not the culprit. If you see the plot here, basically yellow is the sunspot numbers, the envelope of those cycles which we have from 1860 to 2000. And this blue line is the carbon dioxide emission because by man-made regions. And one can see that what you have here is red one is the fluctuations which are essentially smooth. The heavy red line is showing the smooth data for the temperature fluctuations. So the temperature anomaly in degree centigrade from minus 0.6 to plus 0.4 are plotted along this axis. So essentially the global temperature averaged over the whole globe is not very much, but seems to have a trend of warming in the recent years beyond 1960 onwards. It seems to have a continuous increase, which seems to match more closely with the carbon dioxide because of the increasing industrialization and man-made pollutions, which seem to go hand in hand with this. While the sunspot activity cycle, if you see, they seem to have a trend which is decreasing in the recent years. As we saw, the amplitude of the recent cycles have been showing the downward trend, which is downward here, while this is upward. So it seems that as far as the global warming is concerned, the indications are that the sun has been working as it is working now throughout millions of years, and there is no drastic change in its behavior which may justify such a warming. So this is our own making. So I think I'll stop here for today, and